Last week, I got on a plane and flew from Taipei to Phoenix, Arizona, to visit Semicon West. For the first time ever, the semiconductor industry's biggest show is in Phoenix. I spoke to a lot of people on the floor and attended as many presentations as I could. Everyone was amazing, and I learned a lot. 5 years after TSMC's fateful 2020 announcement, the Phoenix semiconductor industry has been on fire, figuratively. In this video, a vibe check into America's semiconductor boom. Yes, it is real. I've gone to Semicon Taiwan and Korea before, but this was my first trip to Semicon West. It was always in San Francisco in July, which conflicted with other things on my schedule. But the shift to Phoenix in October worked better for me, and the new digs made it novel enough to go. I think the current plan is to have the show alternate from now on between San Francisco and Arizona every year. Not sure how long they intend to do that, but the novelty factor meant that this show was well attended. Semi said that 35,000 people attended, maybe 40 or 50% more than what it usually got in San Francisco. There were plenty of curious attendees, including first-timers from Intel or TSMC, who got the day off from work to visit since it's nearby now. I enjoyed my time there. With that being said, however, it might not be the best show for you. It is indeed one of the biggest conferences involved in the semiconductor industry, but that's not always a good thing. When I attended my first semicons back in Taiwan and Korea, I was surprised to find that none of the big fabs, like Intel, Samsung, and TSMC, exhibited there. Most of the companies on the floor I had never heard of before. Here's why. At the start, Semicon was a show held by the fabs and semiconductor makers themselves, but over time it has evolved into a show of equipment makers, hoping to sell to the fabs. So rather than Intel, you have KLA, Lam, Tokyo Electron, and smaller supplier companies. There are good presentations that can be a good education for a beginner, but for the most part, I found most things on the show floor to be just semiconductor adjacent. If you're interested in the science and hard technology, you might need to attend one of the smaller specialized conferences. This year's show, I can sense the tightrope that the sponsoring industry organization Semi has to walk here. The trade and geopolitical situation right now is interesting, to say the least, somewhat volatile. And we must acknowledge that TSMC first came here to Arizona in part because of this. The belief that semiconductor manufacturing must, quote-unquote, come back to the United States resonates throughout the show, couched in dry terms like supply chain resilience. One of this year's major sessions was Resources for Expanding Operations in the United States, featuring a variety of speakers and presentations on topics like speeding up fab construction. And those were quite well attended throughout the 2 days. Yet at the same time, Semi is an international organization. Companies in Asia and Europe are key participants. And nothing is possible without the technology, skill, and expertise contributed by internationals. You don't want to alienate that. So, a big theme that has been repeatedly underlined in this Semicon has been, quote, together stronger, end quote. The Wi-Fi password is literally stronger 25. They might as well get everyone in a circle and go, apes together strong. Another big theme is AI. Not sure if y'all have heard, but AI is kind of hot right now. At Semicon West in Arizona, AI permeated virtually every public discussion from almost every angle you can think of. They refer to today as the AI era. The scale of AI workloads present unprecedented technical challenges on chipmakers, notably incredible energy consumption. Applied Materials pointed out that if we draw a straight line, AI data centers will by themselves consume 10% of global energy consumption by 2030. This trend is obviously unsustainable. There is no single overarching strategy for tackling this, nothing like Dennard scaling had been in the 1990s. Rather, the industry is adopting a multitude of smaller things spanning logic, to memory to packaging. Logic, the forthcoming adoption of gate-all-around and new materials. Memory, the adoption of vertical transistors to scale up DRAM density. And packaging, well, advanced packaging techniques to scale up compute speed and density. There was also a significant amount of talk at the show about using AI to improve semiconductor manufacturing and generally industrial processes. A phrase that I kept hearing over and over again was digital twin. What's that? Well, there are a lot of definitions, but one that I like involves using data from a physical system over some timescale to produce a virtual model of said systems. Insight from the virtual model can then be synchronized back to the physical system. This feedback loop is a key aspect of the value being created by these digital twins. NVIDIA has been pushing this phrase for a long time now. Jensen was talking about it long before ChatGPT was a thing. He wants everything to have a digital twin, from aerospace to energy to the whole Earth itself. At SemiCon, the phrase was everywhere. Digital twins for securing infrastructure, digital twins for smart manufacturing, for design, for optimizing fab operations, for real-time inspection and safety, to propel domestic manufacturing, for testing equipment, autonomous tool operations, training, equipment configurations. You get the deal. Digital twins are quite versatile, no? But I reckon that for a lot of these use cases, you can just say simulation and get similar outcomes. But hey, if it gets the customers to start adopting it, then call it whatever. Worked for AIPC, right? The semiconductor industry has deep roots in Phoenix. The heritage dates back to 1948, when Motorola set up a small electronics research facility in the city. A semiconductor plant was established in 1956 and grew over the years. Then, in 1980, Intel arrived to the town of Chandler in southern Phoenix with Fab 6. And for all their corporate reputation as a ball-busting monopolist, they have been a good corporate citizen in Arizona. In the 15 years after their arrival, Chandler's population doubled, and its average income rose to the second highest in all of Arizona. They have also expanded to the neighboring town of Ocotillo, about 5 or so miles south of downtown Chandler. Motorola left the semiconductor stage long ago, but descendants remain in the city in the form of two organizations. Motorola's old power semiconductor business later became a company called onsemi. onsemi is still headquartered in Phoenix. It employs 1,000 people there. Meanwhile, Motorola's microprocessor and automotive business lines were spin off into Freescale, which was then acquired by the Dutch chip company NXP. They still employ about 1,000 people in Phoenix. At the heart of this new chapter of American semiconductor production is TSMC Arizona. When the news came out about TSMC's decision to site their big American factory on a patch of formerly state-owned desert land, there was plenty of skepticism. People commented that the whole thing would be a boondoggle, comparing TSMC in Arizona to the Foxconn thing back in Wisconsin. And then when the problems hit, articles in both the United States and Taiwan howled about delays and issues. The word debacle was and is used a lot. Bloody chunks of culture clash emerged that netizens eagerly gobbled up, like the thing about the calendar, or the massive attrition, or the insensitive remarks made by both Taiwanese and Americans. The culture clash is still there. There's an ongoing lawsuit about the use of Mandarin in the workplace. That being said, I think it's easy to be negative, confidently asserting that it's all a cynical scam by TSMC to steal water, jobs, dodge tariffs, or whatever. Now it is October 2025. We skewered them when they did wrong, and that's fine because they did plenty wrong, but we should also give credit where credit's due. TSMC has done it. Fab 21, Phase 1, is in high-volume manufacturing, producing actual products. Despite the bad press and smug calls of a debacle, through sheer force of will, they have raised the fab out of literal nothingness. The Greater Phoenix Economic Council estimates that since the start of TSMC's Arizona build in April 2021, the project has created 8,100 jobs and brought $37 billion of capital expenditure to the area. And there is so much more coming too. With six phases, two packaging facilities, and an R&D center someday coming, the council estimates that TSMC will invest some $165 billion in total, producing 40,000 construction jobs and 10,000 more high-tech jobs in the coming years. And like how other fish travel with the whale shark, 43 other semiconductor-related projects have followed. I'm guessing many are Taiwanese equipment suppliers with specialty capabilities, like for instance Allring, an equipment company in the CoWoS supply chain. Probably the single largest accompanying project is the $7 billion factory being built by the American outsourced semiconductor assembly and test company, Amkor. It sits next to the TSMC fab in Peoria, a suburb of Phoenix, which is not in Illinois. They broke ground during the show. This fab is almost literally in the middle of nowhere. So if you imagine Phoenix as expanding outwards from the downtown area, the Intel fab is located in the city of Chandler, south of downtown. Their fab abuts Apache land. TSMC Fab 21 sits in North Phoenix at the margins of the map, a 30 to 40 minute drive from downtown Phoenix, longer with traffic. It really isn't close. Before TSMC arrived, there was only a highway. I got a friend to drive me to the fab, my deepest thanks to him. The first thing I noticed was the fab's striking visual profile. You exit the freeway, make a left turn, and suddenly, there it is. Unlike the fabs in Tainan, you can spot this one from miles away. Security has tightened. You can't pull into the parking lot without a TSMC badge, and it was way too hot to go outside and walk, so I snapped a few things from inside the car, and I hope to get a closer look someday in the future. Phase 1 has had several mistakes with stops and starts, but they have worked their way through that, and now they are really huffing and puffing. Fab 21 Phase 2 is coming up fast, and you can already see the shell, and they are already laying down the groundwork for Phase 3. What feels just as ambitious as the fab itself is the 20-year development plan for the land surrounding it. Right now, there is nothing but desert surrounding the fab, like serious desert. The road just literally ends. Last year, real estate developers Mack Real Estate Group and McCourt Partners bought 2,300 acres of raw desert land surrounding the fab. They then announced a big mixed-use master plan development that they call Halo Vista, which sounds strangely Microsoftian to me. I think they should change the name, considering how both Halo and Vista ended. Maybe call it Minecraft XP? Anyway, this is a billion-dollar project with a mix of industrial, research, commercial, retail, and up to 9,000 residential housing units. Recently, plans were announced for two new Marriott hotels and a Costco there. Maybe this Phoenix Costco will have clam chowder like the ones in Taiwan do. It's wonderful. They're calling it a city within a city, another Hsinchu. Hopefully without the horrid traffic that occurs in Hsinchu during rush hour. I'm having a hard time imagining it, but there we go. By the way, I know there's a lot of internet talk about the water situation and what the build-out means for that. I hopefully will do a video about that later, so let me set this one aside for now. One major ongoing issue has been localization. The meme goes that TSMC Arizona is entirely staffed by Taiwanese immigrants and entirely built with Taiwanese goods, the implication being like, well, it's not really American. I can only tell you what I have seen or what people tell me, and I can tell that folks get diplomatic when they see my face and hear that I am a YouTuber. On the supplier front, it is a process. With Fab 21 Phase 1, TSMC indeed leaned upon components imported from Taiwan. For instance, ducts with specialty linings for chemical transport, exceptions being heavy commodities like concrete and steel. But TSMC is localizing, either due to the volatile tariff situation or because TSMC's local suppliers are said to be having trouble keeping up with the staggering demand coming down the pike thanks to AI. But working with American suppliers has been challenging. No way around it. TSMC is tough on its suppliers. They demand unplanned changes on the fly, often for no rework cost. They always seek a second supplier, and they want very low prices. In Taiwan, TSMC often gets its way because they're so big, and also because Taiwanese business culture favors customer service and a long-term relationship. Suppliers pay for things out of pocket, like those aforementioned rapid changes, to build said relationship. I got the sense that Arizona local suppliers expected a gravy train bonanza, kind of like Intel in the 1990s. So far, that has not been the case. TSMC has pursued many out-of-state vendors, and I get that that's disappointing. Not to mention the cultural element. Intel is demanding, but works like how Americans work. So tensions abound. For potential suppliers looking to work with TSMC, a few things to consider. Prepare to forget everything you think you know about semiconductors. Prepare to move fast and be challenged. And having someone who speaks workable Mandarin and knows the culture definitely helps. And be open to taking what I'm going to call leaps of faith. Try to meet them halfway, and I think they will remember it. The second half of the localization story is the people, and I have much less information about this one. And since it involves the issues of race and immigration, it's more politically charged. I'm going to choose my words carefully here. It is true, and if you think about it, obvious, that TSMC Arizona would not be the success it is today without the Taiwanese. Fab 21 would not be producing so many thousands of wafers per month for customers at good yield. But moving over so many Taiwanese also makes little sense in the long run. The locals I have actually met are polite, but people in the Phoenix subreddit really, really dislike it. And the US government's evolving visa policies will probably make it too expensive for TSMC to keep on with its old ways. Not to mention that TSMC has its own labor shortages back in Taiwan. They sent some of their best and brightest to the United States and probably need them back if they want to come back. So the goal is to slowly localize the Arizona teams, withdrawing the Taiwanese as necessary. How fast this is going apparently differs from team to team. Some are farther along than others. And for what it is worth, I saw plenty of non-Chinese TSMC Arizona people on the show floor. I reckon it will take time, but as TSMC's official YouTube channel, which has just 7,000 followers, go follow it, seems to want to say, it is happening. I really enjoyed my time in Phoenix, but I'm very tired. My trip back home took 20 hours door to door, with all layovers and delays. Once direct flights between Taipei and Phoenix start, I hope to visit more often, and I look forward to meeting more folks in the area and get insight on this massive expansion. Before we leave, I want to touch on the monstrous trend making all of this possible, unfathomable demand for AI chips. A few minutes after getting off the plane from Taipei, I heard about the news about OpenAI and AMD striking a deal. AMD stock soared almost 30% on the news. TSMC stock didn't rise as much, but it went up a good amount too. OpenAI and the other AI labs seem infinitely confident in their ability to consume every token that can be produced. With Intel licking its wounds and Samsung hanging with Elon, the burden is now largely on TSMC to scale up like they have done only a few times before. And signs seem to point to things happening. The stock prices of various Taiwanese semicap or electric equipment suppliers like Allring, Chroma, Winway, and Delta Electric have gone bonkers over the past 6 months. If all this demand develops as promised, then the semiconductor boom in both Taiwan and the United States is likely to continue. It's going to be fun. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.